to start? What I thought we'd do just before we do start, please have a bit of silence for the tragic events that's unfolded in Brussels today. Is to move the notice of motion up to the end of our agenda, so that allows Council Group House to, if you want to leave when that's finished.
I think you took the date on you.
Never know. So, Phil, would you like to take a seat?
So it's authorities take these days, which is not just to look at whether a business is complying with the letter of the tax law, but what the underlying purpose of any transaction that they're doing. And that's since they brought in the general anti-avoidance rules back in whenever it was, 2012, this is it's a change of emphasis. It looks at businesses, it looks to see if the transaction, as I say, was done purely to avoid tax. And if this was the case, then HMRC do now have the opportunity to challenge that transaction and not allow it for tax purposes. So basically, that's it. As I say, it's not going to, it wouldn't, you know, if you think Starbucks did was wrong, this wouldn't actually. You wouldn't pick up the Starbucks in this, but nevertheless, it would be a good policy to adopt, and it would be, as I say, fairly easy to do without causing too much difficulty. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have
you got any questions or comments on this?
Yes, it's called the promotion. Just a question. Is anyone going to come to buy to see that it's going to need to be returned to the family office to report on that order?
Yes, the contract. Well, the local strategy has been updated since 2011. It's fair to say the contract is speaking rules at that time. I've been updated twice. In November 2015, we went to audit committee. We brought in some of the changes that are here. It's part of the, in terms of asking questions.
Okay, so I'm just going to read through the report and go through the points. So just point one, so this provides a progress update on the report submitted to this committee 21st September 2015, which was agenda item 4 entitled Customer Relationship Management System. So it's just a progress update from that report. Point 2.1 just confirms the council has a company license on something called OLE Business Suite, which is a partly implemented enterprise resource planning system which supports the business functions of financials, procurement and CRM There's appendix with the report, appendix one, which just provides some details about how that's implemented on the road. Point 2.2 just describes what CRM is and what it's supposed to do. So that aims to manage customer contact across multiple access channels, for example, customers self-serving on the phone, coming into a one-stop shop, etc. And provides the council with a single view of the customer across disparate services, which are usually in silos, so we don't see that single view of the customer. That's what the CRM is supposed to support. Wirral's implementation of Oracle CRM has actually resulted in a legacy system for environments and regulation for place-based services. So services around street scene focuses on location as opposed to citizens. So we really don't have that single customer interface that sits across all those disparate services at the moment. So that's led to a lack of support in delivering strategic objectives, such as driving digital by default, driving customers online, and service efficiencies. So just moving on to point three and point 3.1, the project mandates and scope. We wanted an improved interface for dealing with the council, for customers, for staff, for partners, for members. We wanted to create a single user account, so to enable single sign-on, so whereas at the moment customers come to our website, have to sign on multiple portals to leisure services, to library services, to council tax, you know, a single sign-on at the front. We wanted the online experience to be as good as other channels, so as good as phoning up, or as good as coming to a one-stop shop, and we wanted to automate those processes end-to-end, which gives us service efficiencies. And from the council's point of view, that then gives us a single view of the customer, which gives us customer insight, which then leads us to making more informed operational strategic decisions and being able to target our resources far better. So, to come up with a specification for Wirral, moving on to point 3.2, we engaged in soft market testing, and this was essentially to go out to the market, to go out to potential CRM suppliers, to engage with them and see what was on offer, see what best practice was out there, whether in the public sector and other local authorities. So we put a soft market testing template on the Northwest iProcurement portal, and we had 24 submissions to that template. We shortlisted those to 10, and we had then had 10 presentations from those suppliers, and we got together a wider stakeholder group, which came from all directorates, from strategy teams, from members were invited as well, from Wirral partners, so we got a full picture of what Wirral wanted as a specification for a system moving forward. So that amounted to, as I say, 10 supplier presentations to over 100 stakeholders across Wirral. So we considered all the Wirral requirements, we got a good view of best practice that was out there. We understood what issues we might have in implementing a new system in our current infrastructure, and we came, our outcome of that was to come up with a refined and robust specification, which we then moved to procurement. So point 3.3, next steps. We're in March, so we're currently getting to the end of reviewing all that soft market testing, further research that was carried out to refine what our Wirral specification is. In April, we're going to sign those off with all stakeholders, which will include members, and then with a view to beginning a procurement exercise. After that, depending on who's successful at the end of that procurement, we'll then have an implementation plan with the supplier to implement a new customer interface.
Something that is easy to use but doesn't assume that everything we put in is something that can be ticked on a box. Mm-hmm. It's very difficult when we have different circumstances from referrals all the time to try and fit it into this very narrow band of things that you keep giving us. Will that be taken into consideration?
I would say the biggest driver in all of this is the flexibility and configurability of the user interface, be that a customer or be that a member or be that a partner, part of the real partnership. So the ease of use of that interface is the biggest driver, absolutely. Regarding putting ticks and boxes and trying to categorise stuff, obviously the reason we do that is because that helps automate the process and save money. And the more we can automate that front end so it can pass seamlessly through into those back office systems, which generally speaking is via drop down fields, tick boxes, etc. That's how we find the efficiencies. Having said that, you know, a simple form can't cover all bases, so I would imagine any process would have the ability to, for free text, to add where it doesn't fit nicely in those different boxes. Just coming back to the user friendliness of it, yeah, absolutely the idea that you could sign into a portal, not have to give your details in every time you want to raise a request, replicating all that information. And also, I think most importantly, this was the feedback we got from councillors, having that view of what's going on in your area, what's going on in your ward, and outstanding requests, and ones that maybe you've been linked to, or ones you haven't even been aware of because they come in kind of a different channel. So big drivers for all of this, yeah.
Page 13, big capital letters. Please do not contact officers by any other method as a responsible option provided. I'm not very happy with this. And the reason being, today I've got an email and it says, please do not respond. And the email was about pedestrian crossing, button roving, and allegedly put in by myself, and it's not. So I went back to Mark Smith straight away, asking if he's away on leave, so I'm in for a couple of days. So this great business is saying, do not contact any officer. I'm sorry, that is totally wrong. That's why we're councillors, that's why we're here for. We're the ones that are up to from the people at time. And when something like this happens, I want to know why it's gone. So you don't want to wait 10 to 15 days for then to come back and say, oh, such and such.
Okay, Chair.
So, Alan's battle.
So, this comment about that was nice and been put on the chest. But it's the pure legislation, pure rules. Yeah. When it's put on the chest, it has to, all the communication has to go through the chest. That's why I say for this way specifically. It's not for the Cllr system.
They can't contact us, this is to make sure.
Oh, sorry, it's understood that. Alright, going back then on the CRMs, why can't we contact the officers?
It comes down to the cost of delivering that service. So, for example, going back to Mark Smith as the director of that service for a specific service request, wherever possible. We are trying to automate those processes so it costs the council less and enables the council to focus the resources on delivering the back-end service as opposed to putting resources into the cost of supporting the contact. So I guess a lot of this work is, and you know, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying those processes are perfect at the moment, hence this piece of work, which is to try and improve those processes and make them much more intuitive. Ideally, with you not needing to contact an individual officer. You know, contacting someone over the phone or in person obviously is a lot more expensive for the council as an organisation than someone who's able to self-serve. This piece of work though recognises that our self-serve channels aren't fit for purpose in some aspects, and they don't meet that high standard of service which you maybe would expect to get from speaking to someone in person or contacting them over the phone. So it's trying to replicate that and drive our contacts online, because the experience online will be as good as talking to someone over the phone or coming into a one-stop shop.
I don't think it's an actual command that you can't break the phone someone, but I think that from what you're saying is not a system to a point where you just don't need to pick up the phone because it's
just only worth the pocket. Yeah, but also recognising there will be and there are vulnerable customers who can't use online, who need the mediated assisted service, but it's again about targeting resources for those services and those people who can have an excellent experience contacting council and accessing our services online. Fantastic. And for talk time, there's also those who can't or aren't able to.
In our ward, Adrian, that sitting in the back there, we've got something like 60 to 80% of people do not have any method of going online in seeking wards. So, you know, when you say, well, go down to one stop shop, come down to one stop shop, you sit and wait an hour and even longer just to say, is the light out? This is not working.
I mean, to counter that, we have provided self-serve facilities in all libraries and one-stop shops, so you can actually come down to a library without being a library member, without needing to a library card, so just log on to a machine there and arrange self-service queries.
Gerry,
yeah,
you want to ask a question?
Can I come back to that, Chair? Well, most libraries are closed.
It's not easy.
Gerry.
Well, go on, Gerry.
Thanks, Jess. All I want to say was I totally agree with the sentiment of John or Christina. I'm really sorry that somehow there isn't a director or a super director here to listen to this and take part in this. So I would like to know where they are actually, because this is something they should know about. Starting to make blunt. But the fact is, I think that officers, I can understand you want more efficiencies. But you can't expect councillors to go away from their basic role of talking to people. And we talk with our residents, we want to talk to officers as well. And any suggestion, John, as you criticising point out, that we can't talk to officers, we've got to go through these systems, it's just totally unacceptable as far as I'm concerned. It might be all right for the young whiskey Matthew, and Tom, of course, but the rest of us, we're not quite, I'm afraid, geared up to do what you, Matthew, can do, and you, Tom, you can have your idea. You've got to back off on this, and you've got to tell the directors, somebody, I wish they were here.
Well, to be fair, this was just an updated report, so they weren't.
Yeah.
We didn't request that they attend because this is just an updated report.
Well, we need to more than update it. We need to get the message over to them. Thank you.
Did you want to come back on?
Yeah, I was going to say statistically, you know, usage of, for example, smartphones, tablets is rising exponentially. So there will be pockets like Seacombe where there isn't that maybe high uptake. And this is all about targeting our costly mediated services like one-stop shops and the call centre at those customers who aren't able to access online. But for the majority, and it is increasingly becoming an overwhelming majority out there, that people are able and willing to do stuff online, as their experience to doing stuff online in the private sector, be it online shopping, you know, etc. So we want to create the tools that enable people to be confident to transact with council on that, but not offer the opportunity for customers who can't access online to access our services by phone and face to face.
I mean, in fairness, the government do expect the universal credit claimants and a lot of benefit claimants to make their claim online. So we're not out to step large organisations, we're not. Anita and Christina wanted to.
Thanks, Chair. I just wanted to comment really that hopefully this will be an efficient system that's introduced and that will eliminate the need for us to contact the officers, and I'm sure that we'll receive some training, so we can only hope in that matter. The point that I wanted to raise, Chair, is on page 16, it talks about a single view of the customer across multiple services. I just really wanted to make a comment there. You know, there are some sensitivities amongst data held for some of our customers, and I just wanted to make sure that data protection is fully covered in that matter.
Yeah, absolutely. That's in the specification already that we need to protect our data, absolutely, and access to it. Yeah.
Christina,
and
I just
want
to go back to the point
that
Jerry's made about not speaking to officers in terms of us as councillors. And I think many of us have heard about the email that was sent out, whether it was or not, I don't know, but because we're not privy to know whether it was in fact sent out, saying not to speak to councillors. But if we send in something that somebody's told us about and they've sent it in, we won't possibly get the same answer because it'll go down the same channel. So it's just making, A, making work for us, and B, not having a regard for the job of a councillor, because people come to us because they think, as their elected representatives, we've got some sort of way in to help sort out problems. But if we have to go the same route as them, it's going to take us ages. We're going to constantly be having to go back to see where we are in the system. We're going to lose things. It's going to make our job more difficult. And it seems to me, as I end my 4 years here, that it's almost like you're sort of just leaving councillors to drift without any appreciation of what they're supposed to do. And it does worry me. I don't think it's... I can understand what you're saying and what you're doing, and I can understand why with the cuts, but from our point of view, it does make life more difficult. Especially if we hit a brick wall, what are we supposed to do?
It's, I think we are the IT department. Yeah. We've been asked to do this new CLM system, which we are looking at. What you're saying is how you communicate with parts of the business. You're saying that with the IT department, how you talk to the other parts has to be done, as you say, by the directors and all that.
Sorry, the point I'm making is, if we are being told now, this is the system you will follow, and it doesn't include in it us being able, not all the time, because none of us take advantage of this, but when we need to, talking to officers who we know, to try and find a way around a problem, then it makes life difficult for us, and if it's written into something that is written by your department, it gives us not a leg to stand on. And I would just like to say that, of course, there's nobody here to take this back, but there should be somebody here to take it back to, so you get it put in. That's the point I'm making.
Well, I think what we could request is that Lisa Jameson attends the next committee, because I think some of these, whilst these are all really valid concerns, and they've been moving on for a while now, I'm not so sure if you should be getting it all. Because you just come here to give us updates.
We don't need assessments.
We don't, we're not attacking.
Can we just move on to Tom and then
that? Just quickly. So Lisa Jameson is one of our key stakeholders and has been engaged as part of this process. So yes, absolutely. She's working on future customer contact. And that has
I think she'll be in the best position to address some of these, Tom.
Yeah, Chair, I think you still got the bar over from our frustration regarding the contacting officers. Just to comment on that, really, our contact officers, when it's urgent and need to meet here, falling down the street, like through a wall, benefits pay that's gone wrong, and people have maybe safeguarding an issue. So let's hope that will go through this, by the way. So, just two concerns on this. Will there still be an effort for people to contact the council and report serious things? So, like, street lamps falling out through walls, how we have to go about it. And the other thing is accessing it on tablets. Unfortunately, I can't access it on any tablets whatsoever. It's been a frustration for the last year. So I'm still in that issue. You can see a lot of the bits in this.
So the answer is yes, there are issues which clearly don't fit online, so serious issues that require a very quick response. So there will be a provision for making those online with a very clear escalation, but you'll still have to need to contact by phone or face-to-face. So absolutely, issues which need to be prioritised very quickly, there will be a process for that. And one of the part of the specification will be the new interface will be compliant for any device and operating system. So that's very much one of our other focuses as well, and that has to work on any device seamlessly. Is that what you meant? I don't know what your particular issues
are. We have to connect to the council VPN, don't we, to go through the internet. So would it be an outside login through the website that an external user would use?
That is something that's in our specification because we need to support the rural partnership. So partner, so customer access, staff access, member access, partner access. It needs to be, as we mentioned before, completely flexible and configurable. Absolutely. So we're at the process of refining the specification that will go out to tender, so it's intended to go out, out to tender by April.
And what's the time going on?
That will depend on the specification that we sign off and obviously an implementation plan that we agree with a successful supplier.
So once the new contract's in place then it will be a good time to be all the tasks are finished and all that. Of course we've got to get the time to bed then as well.
Wouldn't that be too late? So yeah.
Well, it's out to tender now, is it?
We're at the point of refining the specification, but to be clear, so actually, we're still at the point that we can take contributions, but it has already gone out to all all office managers to say which members would like some input in this, and we have had input via email or members actually attending in person, so we have had some input from members on what the future interface looks like.
So we could put this as a priority on our work programme.
Was overseen by a different committee arrangement. So really this has been on the agenda
responsibility with that change in responsibility. Okay, so this report that I'm presenting today is to set out what the statutory requirement is for a community safety partnership and to provide the members here with an update on the arrangements and the priorities set by the partnership. And I've also taken the opportunity to highlight the two World 2020 pledges that specifically link into the work around the partnership. So, the partnership itself is responsible for overseeing the delivery of the community safety aspects of the Wallasey agency representatives who are delivering around community safety. The council, as a legal authority, has a responsibility in legislation for the Crime and Disorder Act to have a community safety partnership, and we've had one in place since 1998. The current community safety partnership arrangements have been operating under the brand of Safer World, and some of you may have seen that branding on various adverts that are out there. The committee meets, or sorry, the partnership meets on a quarterly basis, and the attendance of that partnership is made up of all the agencies that are listed on in paragraph 3.4. And I've also taken the move since taking over responsibility for this area in the last sort of 12 months or so to make sure that we've got an elected member representative at that partnership as well. And we have small representatives from each of the three groups to attend that. And I know Councillor Leech comes to represent the Labour group, and obviously the portfolio holder, and Councillor Fraser represents the Conservative group. So we've got representation there. Like I said, it meets on a quarterly basis. It agrees a set of priorities which have to be published on an annual basis, and they're published on the internet. And for the period 2014-16, so up until April this year, those priorities were listed on in paragraph 3.6. And that's what the partnership measured its success, if you like, against either reductions in those or seeking behaviour to alter and change and address those issues. It was felt by the partnership that with the move towards the 2020 plan and the pledges, with one specific pledge around ensuring Wales' neighbourhoods are safe, that we reviewed those community safety partnership priorities and actually to make them or take them more in line with the outcomes of those that pledge, which was agreed by Cabinet only Monday this week. What I've also done, however, is to try and reassure members of this committee that even though we've moved to the strategic priorities set within that pledge, this has happened in, concurrently with Merseyside Police moving away from a systematic measurement based purely on reduction in crime figures and moved to more of a holistic approach within their neighbourhood policing plan. However, we've agreed as a partnership, and the police, as one of the key partners in that partnership, have agreed that at a local level, so through our partnership, we will continue to monitor the rates of criminality and behaviour against that list that's set in the table on in paragraph 3.7. However, we won't be using those necessarily as determining factors, and more as sense checks as we move forward with the delivery of the work plan. So, moving on to the report in terms of the future, I mentioned about the two pledges. We based the pledges on a wide consultation, primarily through the partnership and as a result of the survey results. And within the ensuring Wales neighbourhoods are safe, pledge number 19, that came up, or we agreed four key priority areas with the working of the delivery plan against those strategic pledges and those four strategic aims, if you like, are first of all in to build safer, stronger and more confident communities. So this is very much about increased engagement with our neighbourhoods and our communities, seeking to build on the excellent work already undertaken by a whole plethora of voluntary agencies, whether they be attached to the fire service, whether they be attached to the police, whether they be neighbourhood watch. So really to do a bit of focus work with those to see if we can get more people signed up to those schemes and more people in communities to take more ownership around this. So we're very keen to do that in terms of building these safer and more stronger communities. One of the key things that came from the survey was about tackling the cause and the impact of antisocial behaviour. We are fully aware that this is can be an absolute blight of certain areas in certain locations. There's been many years of trying to tackle antisocial behaviour, and I have to say that sitting here as the lead officer in this area, I speak to you with an 8-year reduction in reported antisocial behaviour, but I am still very much aware that those people who experience antisocial behaviour, it really is a traumatic experience for them. Hence the decision to really work with the existing antisocial behaviour team on a more practical level to get them more engaged in the communities, and that's very much the direction that we're looking to do. And hopefully through your constituency work and your ward work, you've started to, you've hopefully seen more of an overt presence of the ASB team in certainly engaging. And if you haven't, I'm happy to sort of receive any direct conversation about any ASB complaints to make sure that those officers can be tasked to do that. The CSB itself, however, in terms of this, we understand that ASB is a very difficult thing to tackle because of the range of what considers to be antisocial behaviour. It can literally range from everything that you see come back on that survey, from dogfighting in the street all the way up to persistent windows being stoned and things by problematic gangs and things of that nature. So in terms of tackling it, we understand that it's going to be quite a complicated approach with a number of different ways to try and deal with the different issues. One area that did come back though is about trying to tackle this perception of crime, perception of safety against the reality. And I think this is very much linked into, in some areas, about the issue around social isolation, about people not feeling sure, and about how we engage with that. If young people want to stand on the street, as long as they're not causing any harm, then question why should we ask them to move along, purely because somebody feels that they're threatened and feel unsafe by them. So it's about understanding where that comes from in those areas. And that strategic priority is very much looking at that. We also think within that same area of work, there's some really, really exciting delivery going online where we're actually now, within this whole strategy, I think the public require and probably demand that they see a very clear, overt lead authority, which should be the police, in terms of tackling crime behaviour and antisocial behaviour. And in terms of that, we're very much looking about moving resources from where they exist at the moment, maybe within council operationally controlled areas, to actually say to the police, well, here you go, you can have them, and actually as part of your operational delivery, why don't you deal with those and task them as appropriate in those areas. So that started to take shape, some of that work. And the final bit just on that priority I want to mention is the success of our neighbourhood justice scheme as well. Again, when we look at the plethora of this and what goes on, we launched a scheme some 12 months or so ago where we were very keen to look at other ways of tackling those low level in terms of criminality, but neighbour to neighbourhood type disputes where actually there probably isn't a single thing other than, dare I say, returning the mic off, taking someone around the back and banging two heads together and saying, like, well, just really beat me together. Well, unfortunately, we can't do that all the time. The restorative justice